Hello everyone, in this video lecture I'll be discussing about instrumental method of analysis. So here I'll be discussing the basic principles involved in the instrumental analysis. Next I'll take up with the two aspects of instrumental analysis. One is colorimetry and other is potentiometry. So let's discuss all this in detail in the coming slide. Analytical chemistry is a branch of chemistry which deals with methods for determining the chemical composition of sample, that is the chemical analysis. So there are two types of analysis, one is qualitative, one more is quantitative. A qualitative method yields information of identity of chemical species or functional group in the sample. A qualitative method has a wide range of application in medicinal and criminology section. A quantitative method, in contrast, provides information about amount of substance or concentration present in the given sample. Quantitative method is having a wide range of application in food industry. Quantitative method of analysis involves three different methods of analysis. First is titrometry, that is titration. Next is gravimetry. Third is instrumental analysis. In this slide, I'll be discussing about three basic aspects of quantitative analysis. First is nothing but titrimetry. So titrimetry is nothing but titrations or volumetric analysis. The substance to be analyzed is made to react with the standard solution of an appropriate reagent. So this kind of analysis you have done in the 10 plus 2 level, that is the simple titrations. Second is nothing but gravimetry. Here the substance to be analyzed is precipitated by adding a precipitating reagent. The precipitate is thus collected and weighed. Third one is instrumental analysis. So here we basically use instrument to measure the quantity of an analyte by relating the concentration with light absorption, conductivity or potential. So these are the three types of analysis involved in quantitative method. So here I will be discussing about the advantages and disadvantages of instrumental method. First I will go through the advantages. Instrumental method of analysis, it's a faster method compared to the other methods. It requires a very small sample for analysis. The results are very accurate and reliable. So these are some of the important advantages of instrumental method of analysis. Next we will see the disadvantages. The cost of the instruments are very high. Handling the instruments requires specialized training. Frequent calibration is also one of the important problems what the people are facing. The other disadvantage is nothing but the sensitivity and accuracy depends upon the type of instrument and the make of instrument. Instrumental method of analysis can be classified into two types, electrical method and optical method. In electrical method, it involves the measurement of current, voltage or resistance in order to calculate or find the concentration of certain species present in a given solution. Example is potentiometry and conductometry. Optical method. These are based on how the sample act towards electromagnetic radiation in order to calculate or find the concentration of certain species present in a given solution. Example is flame photometry, AAS, that is atomic absorption spectroscopy, and colorimetry. In the below diagram, we can see how the instrumental method of analysis function. In instrumental method of analysis, a light signal, heat, current, or voltage is applied from an instrument to the sample. Next, the analytical signal from the analyte or the sample is detected by the detector. So this detector converts the electrical signal, which is later processed by the signal processor and next amplified. Finally, it is transformed into the output or readout of the computer or the device. So this is how the instrumental method of analysis function. Colorimetry. It is an analytical technique used to determine the concentration of substance in a solution which are colored or which gives a color when mixed with suitable reagent. When light radiation like visible light are passed through a sample, a part of it is absorbed, resulting in decrease in intensity of radiation. The wavelength of radiation absorbed is a characteristic of that substance, and the quantity of radiation absorbed is a function of its concentration. Thus, colorimetry follows Beer-Lambert's law, which states that concentration of the solute is proportional to the absorbance. In this part, I will be discussing about the theory, instrumentation, procedure, and the application of colorimetry. First, I will start up with the theory of colorimetry. When a monochromatic radiation of intensity I0 is passed through a solution of sample under investigation taken in a cell of thickness T, a portion of radiation is absorbed, that is IA, a portion of light is reflected, that is IR, and the remainder is transmitted, that is IT. Then I0 equal to IA plus IR plus IT. For a glass cell, IR is negligible. Therefore, I0 equal to IA plus IT. According to Lambert's law, when a monochromatic light passes through a transparent medium, the intensity of light decreases exponentially as thickness of the absorbing medium increases arithmetically. Mathematically, it can be represented as IT equal to I0 e to the power minus KT, where I0 is the intensity of intense incident light and IT is the intensity of transmitted light. The transmittance T is given by T equal to IT by I0. The logarithm of reciprocal of transmittance is nothing but the optical density or absorbance A. Absorbance A is given by A equal to log 1 by T, which is nothing but log I0 by IT. Thus, Lambert's law can be expressed as A equal to log I0 by IT, which is nothing but KT. So this is nothing but the equation 1, where K is a constant and T is the thickness of the medium. Thus, this equation 1 shows that absorbance is directly proportional to the thickness of the medium. So absorbance is directly proportional to T, where T is the thickness of the medium. According to the Beer's law, when a monochromatic light is passed through a transparent medium, the intensity of transmitted light decreases exponentially as the concentration of the medium increases arithmetically. Mathematically, Beer's law is given by A equal to log I0 by IT, which is equal to K dash C, where K dash is a constant and C is the concentration of the substance. So this represents equation 2. So thus equation 2 shows that absorbance is directly proportional to the concentration of the medium. Combining equation 1 and 2 for Beer-Lambert's law, the Beer-Lambert's law can be written as A equal to log I0 by IT, which is equal to epsilon CT, where epsilon is a molar absorption coefficient, which is nothing but a constant for a given substance at a particular wavelength. If the path length T or thickness of the cell is kept constant, then absorbance A is proportional to the concentration C. Therefore, absorbance is directly proportional to the concentration. Therefore, the absorbance A is directly proportional to concentration of the substance when thickness of the medium is kept constant is called as Beer-Lambert's law. Let me start with the instrumentation of colorimetry. The instrument used to measure the absorbance of the solution is known as photoelectric colorimeter. The essential parts of the colorimetry is shown in the below diagram. It contains a tungsten lamp as a light source. Next, a slit is provided. A slit is adjustable, which allows a beam of light to pass through it, thus preventing the unwanted light. Next, a convexing lens. Light after passing through the slit falls on this kind of lens, which gives a parallel beam of light. Next, a filter, which provides the desired wavelength range where solution gives maximum absorbance, or the use of filter is just to convert the polychromatic light into monochromatic light. Next, a sample holder, that is a cuvette, to take up the solution. a detector or a photocell to receive the transmitted light and to convert the transmitted light into the electrical measurable signal. Finally, recorder is provided. The use of the recorder is to measure the response of the photocell and to give the output. In this slide, I will be discussing about the procedure of colorimetry. First, 5 different standard flasks are taken of capacity 50 ml each. Next, 5 ml, 10 ml, 15, 20, 25 ml of copper sulfate is added to separate standard flask. Next, 5 ml of ammonia is added to each of these flasks and make up to the mark using distilled water. The flasks are well stoppered and shaken well for informed concentration. The complex thus obtained is known as cupromonium sulfate. It's a blue color complex. Next, a blank solution is prepared by taking 5 ml of ammonia, making up to the mark using distilled water and shaken well for informed concentration. The absorbance of all these solutions against blank is measured at 620 nanometer using colorimetry. Next, a test solution is taken which contains unknown amount of copper sulfate. To that solution, 5 ml of ammonia is added. Next, water is added, made up to the mark using distilled water and shaken well for informed concentration. Finally, the absorbance of the test solution is checked against the blank at 620 nanometer using the colorimeter. A calibration curve is drawn by plotting concentration of copper against absorbance. A graph is plotted with concentration as x-axis, absorbance as y-axis. A straight line passing through origin is seen. Next, absorbance of the test solution is plotted. From this, the concentration of copper present in the test solution can be formed. Applications of colorimetry. It is used to determine the concentration of metals present in ores. Estimation of biochemical compounds in blood, plasma, urine and serum. Test the water quality by screening for compounds such as chlorine, fluoride and cyanide. They are also used to measure and monitor the color in various foods and beverages including vegetable products. In this part, I will be discussing about potentiometry. Potentiometry is an analytical method in which amount of substance present in the solution is determined by measurement of EMF between two electrodes that are dipped into the solution. The two electrodes used are indicator electrode and Kalman electrode. Kalman electrode or the reference electrode are the electrode whose electrode potential is fixed or constant, whereas the indicator electrode is the electrode whose potential changes with change in concentration of the ions present in the solution. So let's start with the principle of potentiometry. When a metal M is immersed in a solution containing its own ion, metal ion, the electrode potential is given by the Nernst equation, that is E equal to E naught plus 0.0591 divided by N log concentration of metal ion. E can be measured by combining the electrode with the reference electrode and measuring the EMF of the cell. The concentration can be calculated provided E naught of the electrode is known. So here E is the electrode potential, E naught is the standard electrode potential. The indicator electrode and the Kalman electrode are combined together to form the galvanic cell and dipped into the solution of the analyte and connected to the potentiometry. A potentiometer is used to measure the cell potential and to determine the concentration of the ions present in the solution. In potentiometric titration, generally a known volume of the analyte is titrated against standard solution. During the course of titration, concentration of the product will be continuously altered. As the potential of Kalman electrode remains constant, any change in cell potential is due to the change in the potential of indicator electrode during titration. Here, indicator electrode is the electrode whose potential depends upon the concentration of the ions present in the solution of the analyte. Initially, the change in potential is very small. At equivalence point, when the amount of titrant is added to the analyte, there is a sharp jump or rise in the potential. Beyond the equivalence point, there will be no significant change in the potential. By plotting the graph of change in potential against volume of the titrant added, the equivalence point can be determined. You can see in the below graph the plot of delta E by delta V versus V, volume of the solution. We can calculate the equivalence point. So in this slide I will be discussing about the instrumentation of potentiometry. A known volume of the analyte is taken in a beaker. Next, the calomel and platinum electrodes are dipped in the analyte solution and it's connected to the potentiometry. The solution is stirred well and initial cell potential EMF is noted. Next, the titrant is added in increments from the burette of 0.5 ml to the analyte solution and EMF is measured each time after stirring the solution. The process is continued till the equivalence point where EMF increases sharply. A few readings are taken beyond this equivalence point, thus the change in potential at different volumes of the titrant are recorded. Classification of potentiometric titration. Potentiometric titration can be classified into three types: neutralization titration, redox titration, and precipitation titration. First, I will be dealing with neutralization titration. If a solution of acid such as hydrochloric acid is titrated against base, that is sodium hydroxide, electrode potential is dependent on H plus ion concentration. Here the two electrode used is glass electrode and calomel electrode. The glass electrode is used as an indicator electrode which is coupled with the calomel electrode and dipped in a solution of known volume of the analyte, that is hydrochloric acid, and connected to the potentiometry and EMF is measured. E cell is given by the formula E cell equal to E reference, that is E calomel, plus 0.0591 pH. The titrant of known concentration is added in increments of 0.5 ml from the burette to the analyte solution HCl and EMF is measured each time after stirring the solution. A sudden jump is seen at the equivalence point. A plot of delta E by delta V versus volume is plotted. From that, equivalence point can be calculated. Next is nothing but the redox titration. Titration of FAS versus potassium dichromate. Titration involving more salt solution and potassium dichromate can be done using potentiometry. The platinum electrode is used as an indicator electrode and it is coupled with the calomel electrode, that is reference electrode, and dipped in a solution of known volume of the analyte, that is more salt solution, and connected to the potentiometry. Next, the EMF is measured. The more salt solution initially contains ferrous ion. When the titrant potassium dichromate from the known concentration is added in increments of 0.5 ml from the burette to the analyte solution, EMF is measured each time after stirring the solution. FAS reacts with the potassium dichromate under acidic condition. So potassium dichromate is acting as a oxidizing agent which will oxidize ferrous ion to ferric and itself undergoes reduction from chromium plus 6 to plus 3 ion in acidic condition. The redox electrode potential is set up by the indicator electrode which is given by platinum Fe2 plus ion and Fe3 plus ion. The electrode potential of the redox electrode is given by Nernst equation E equal to E0 plus 0.0591 divided by N log concentration of Fe3 by Fe2 plus ion. The electrode potential depends upon the concentration of Fe2 plus ion and Fe3 plus ion. As the titration proceeds, Fe3 plus ion increases and Fe2 plus ion decreases and redox electrode potential increases and EMF of the cell goes on increasing and steep rise is seen at equivalence point. At equivalence point, all the Fe2 plus ion is getting converting into Fe3 plus ion and redox potential of platinum Fe2 plus and Fe3 plus stops and further addition of dichromate, a new redox potential comes into the existence, platinum chromium plus 6 and chromium plus 3 ion. Because the solution contains chromium plus 3 ions, produced due to the reduction of dichromate by Fe2 plus ion. This redox electrode platinum chromium plus 6 and chromium plus 3 has high potential than platinum Fe2 plus and Fe3 plus ion. A plot of graph of delta E by delta V versus volume of dichromate gives the equivalence point. Precipitation titration. Consider a titration of silver nitrate versus standard KCl, where silver ions are precipitated as silver chloride. The silver electrode is used as indicator electrode and calomel electrode is used as reference electrode. The potential can be measured as E equal to E naught plus 0.0591 log concentration of silver ion. The titrant of known concentration KCl is added in increments of 0.5 ml from the burette to the analyte solution containing silver ions. These are next precipitated as silver chloride. The concentration of silver ion decreases during the process and EMF is measured each time after stirring the solution. A sudden jump is seen at equivalence point. A plot of delta E by delta V versus volume can be plotted to get the equivalence point.